This is a Canon R5, and it's one of the most impressive cameras released in recent years, capable of capturing incredible images with superb colours and fantastic autofocus. Its video mode is equally as impressive, as it can shoot 8K video, which is a first in a camera of this size, and what's more, it can even downsample that 8K to 4K, resulting in detail levels that can't be touched by anything in this price range. However, there's one major flaw in video mode, which is that in the higher quality modes, it overheats, which is hugely problematic when it's being used for any kind of professional work, as reliability is incredibly important. The worst part about this, though, is that Canon seems to have done very little to mitigate this overheating, which you'll soon see, and that means that really there's so much potential here that's being wasted. So in this video, in an attempt to make this a more usable tool, we're going to be modifying the internals so that it has enhanced cooling, resulting in overheating becoming a non-issue. Let's get to it. This video is sponsored by SimpliSafe, and right now they're having their best sale of the year. More on that later. When Canon officially announced the R5 in the spring of 2020, it caused quite a lot of excitement, not only due to its full-frame 8K video capability, but that it complements this with in-body sensor stabilization and autofocus that's so good it can keep an eye sharp even when using fast lenses that have a really shallow depth of field. Nothing else has this combination of features, so you can imagine how disappointing it was for reports of overheating to start to surface on the internet, with some early adopters finding that even the camera just being on would cause the allowable record time to decrease, making it frustrating to use in practice. For some context, the camera as released can record about 20 minutes of 8K video before overheating, which sounds fine if it were for individual takes, but it's actually accumulative, and once overheated it takes up to 2 hours to cool down enough to record another 20 minutes, so it's pretty nail-biting to use for actual work. Taking a look at it through a thermal camera, we can begin to see a few hints of the problem, as there's definitely a visible hotspot on the back after just 5 minutes of recording, as if there's a heat-generating component just behind this plastic. So, let's take a look and see. Okay, so now that we're in, we can see the area that was hot when the camera was running. But taking a close look at it, we can see that it's actually just a DC to DC power regulator board that probably handles charging as well. Regulators like this are pretty efficient though, so while it probably generates some of its own warmth, it shouldn't be causing the amount of heating we observed earlier. Interestingly, it is mounted to a metal platform, though I have a feeling that this platform has more to do with what's underneath it. Yep, there we go. This looks like the main processor for the camera, which explains why this area got particularly hot when it was recording earlier. Weirdly though, these thermal pads don't even cover the processor properly, so won't be transferring heat as well as they could do into the metal platform. Strange. So, even if the processor only generates a small amount of heat, that heat isn't going anywhere fast, because its thermal pathway to get rid of the heat isn't great, because it's got to go through two thermal pads, which aren't really positioned well and aren't great conductors of heat anyway, and then into a metal plate. Now, that's okay, but then from the metal plate, there's nowhere really for the heat to go, because it's got a PCB on top, which will generate a small amount of heat in itself, and then there's an air gap, and then the final outer plastic casing, which is again fairly insulative. So it's no real wonder that there are some heat problems here. Now, I'm still not 100% sure that the processor is the source of heat, so let's check it out with a thermal camera. Whoa! The hottest part on this PCB is about 85 degrees Celsius, which is very toasty. Let's see if we can work out what the area of the processor itself is underneath. Okay, so the PCB area around the processor is about 82 degrees Celsius, and that's not the
processor itself, that's just the PCB area around it. So to me, that definitely does look like it is getting hot, and it sure does look like the processor is the cause of that heat. So to make sure that any mod has a chance of working, I need to targetedly cool this area to see whether the camera then decides that it's not overheating. So to do this, I'm actually going to be using water cooling.
So to start off, I'm going to utilize a couple of tiny little water blocks from AlphaCool. But because the power board has to clip into place above the processor, which is what we're trying to cool, I can't attach them directly to it. So instead, I'm going to use a small piece of 1mm thick copper to make a rudimentary heat spreader to pull heat out from underneath the power board. Copper is a great conductor of heat, so it should do well for this. Once the water blocks are screwed in place, they're ready for some tubing, which can then be hooked up to some adapters that interface with standard computer water cooling components. Here I've got a small radiator, again from AlphaCool, which I attached in line with a pump and reservoir. As you can see, the flow isn't amazing or anything due to the diameter of the small tubes, but even so, it should handle a lot of heat. To test it, I shoved 15 watts into a tech element and it was able to keep the hot side reasonably cool, so that should be plenty for what's needed here. I'm going to mount this little water block directly to the processor with some thermal compound, which is typically much better at transferring heat than thermal pads, and to keep it in place, I'm going to be using the original metal plate. With the power board clipped back in place too, the rear of the camera can be plugged back in as well.
Right, let's hope it still turns on. Okay, good. Right, so it's turning on okay, it's all ready to test out. And with all the cooling it could possibly want, we need to see how long it's going to record for. And remember, we have 20 minutes here to beat.
So we're just coming up to 20 minutes now, so this is going to be the moment of truth.
Right, so we've just... Oh no! Oh... It's not hot! It's not even warm! That's the crazy thing, it's not even warm. The whole thing is cold. That is ridiculous. Well, to be honest, I was sort of expecting something like this to happen because there's been a lot of speculation on the internet that the overheating on here is timer-based. And that does indeed appear to be the case because even with an excessive cooling solution like this, the camera is still overheating at about the 20-minute mark, regardless of its internal temperature. Some people have gone further and claimed that the overheating is fake because of this, but I don't believe that's the case because, as we observed earlier, the camera was still getting very hot inside before this cooling solution was added. It's just that it appears that Canon has chosen a timer to manage the heat problem rather than properly monitoring internal temperatures, which caused a lot of confusion and a bit of an uproar around the internet. So Canon quickly released a firmware update that changes the way the camera monitors internal temperatures. So that's our only hope at this point, so let's give this a firmware update and see if anything changes.
With the update complete and the water cooling running, the camera flies past the 20-minute mark, so things are looking much more promising this time round. Taking a look at it through the thermal camera again shows that the internal temperatures remain less than half of what they were originally, and briefly turning off the water cooling shows the whole area rapidly increase in temperature, reaching nearly 70 degrees after just a few minutes. The tubing isn't designed for these temperatures, however, so I decided to quickly turn it on again before things got out of hand.
So I'm happy to report that the camera's been recording for over 4 hours now and there's no sign of any overheating, not even any warning on the screen. So this cooling solution is allowing it to record for apparently an unlimited length of time, which is fantastic, and I think it's that firmware update that's made all the difference.
Now, to make sure that it wasn't the firmware update alone that resulted in these extended record times, I did do some subsequent tests with the camera put back together into its original state, and even with the firmware update, it could only manage an extra 6 minutes of 8K recording before overheating. So the water cooling definitely does its job in aiding the camera to keep cool when recording. So now that we know for sure that the camera is capable of unlimited record times when coupled with an external cooling solution, we need to trim this down as far as possible so that it's obviously a lot more elegant, because having it hooked up to all of these tubes is not exactly very practical. So that is the next step. But before that, it's time for a quick ad from this video's sponsor, SimpliSafe. SimpliSafe offer a wide range of easy to install sensors and cameras that can all work together to make a custom security setup catered for your needs with no contracts. They've got motion detectors, entrance sensors, water triggers and many more, all controlled by a central hub and keypad, making them really easy to pair and set up in less than an hour. As the sensors are wireless, it makes their installation quick and hassle-free, allowing them to be installed almost anywhere. Their cameras too can be monitored live from your smartphone, with instant alerts if they detect activity, and audio pass-through, which is helpful to, for example, talk to somebody at your door with the doorbell camera if you aren't at home. You can even add professional monitoring for when you need even more security, allowing the police to be called if necessary, or even the fire services, which works brilliantly along with the smoke sensor. Now, I've got my place fully kitted out with a whole array of sensors, and it really does give peace of mind. So if you want to get your place secure too, then visit simplisafe.com/DIYperks, as through that link you can get 40% off their home security systems plus a free HD camera, which is great value. So get your home secure today with that link, which you can also find below. The plan I have for trimming down this cooling solution starts with improving the camera's internal thermal design, which is going to necessitate fabricating a much thicker replacement for the camera's original metal platform, for which I'm going to use 2mm thick copper plate, again because it transfers heat exceptionally well. After cutting out a paper template and marking it onto the copper, I can now carefully cut it out with a jigsaw, refining the edges with a file. As the original platform does rise up slightly, I'm going to achieve this with mine by getting some 1mm plate and brazing it to the bottom of the main copper piece. After some cleanup, I can now drill some holes into it and bridge them together to match the original. After doing a similar job for the other side and polishing it up, it's turned out looking pretty neat. Now, remaking this platform is one thing, but it's not going to improve cooling on its own with the power PCB still blocking heat transfer to the outer plastic case, so I made an extra little offcut that fits onto the bottom left of my new platform, as there's just enough room here for it to sit on top of an internal cable plug. This is literally the only place that allows direct, unhindered access to the back of the camera's casing, so for us it's a pretty fortunate part of the camera's design. Before mounting this in place properly, however, I have added some tape to mask off areas that don't directly touch the processor and DRAM to be doubly sure about not shorting anything out, and I'm again using some thermal compound for optimal heat transfer. The same goes for the power board. So this is looking great, almost as if it was built this way, and to finish things off, my final task is to add some thermal pads of varying thicknesses to bridge as much as possible to the back of the camera. The PCB area itself won't transfer much heat, but every little helps, and the new exposed copper section only needs a thin thermal pad to make direct contact, so it should transfer heat into it reasonably well. This makes the back of the camera effectively an open heatsink, although it's very unlikely to work on its own, but we'll be exploring that in just a minute. My reservations as to whether this can get rid of the heat on its own now comes down to thermodynamics. You see, even a small 10-watt LED mounted directly onto an aluminium heatsink still gets pretty hot after about half an hour, and that's despite being exposed to open air. And the way it gets rid of the heat is purely through convection. Our camera, for example, not only has a much smaller area than this heatsink does, but it's likely generating more heat because the 10-watt LED is about 30% efficient, so that means 7 watts of heat. I would say this is probably using more closer to 10 watts, or you know, between 7 and 10 anyway. So that's quite a lot of heat that has to be gotten rid of through a fairly small surface area that's not even that conductive as it's plastic. So for now we need to see how long this can record for as is. This time round, the camera was happy to record for about 39 minutes before shutting down, which is 43% longer than just the firmware update alone, which I'd say is pretty good going. The best part about this though is that after just a 5-minute break, the camera was happy to record for another 30 minutes, and this behaviour continued apparently indefinitely, so it must be on the cusp of being able to be kept cool passively. I confirmed this theory by testing it out in a cooler room, and this time the camera just kept on going until I was too tired and needed to go to bed. This is all thanks to the new internal copper piece being able to dump the heat from the processor directly into the back plastic, which then slowly dissipates this into the surrounding air. So that actually fared a lot better than I thought that it might do, and honestly for a lot of situations that would be perfectly acceptable, as you can just take a 5-minute break every half an hour to record another half an hour, which is much better than the 2 hours it was taking before, which really does go to show how restricted the camera was at getting rid of the heat by just the poor thermal pathway. However, we still haven't been able to achieve unlimited record times, which was the original goal of this video, so even though we're going to have to add something extra to it, I think it will be worth it to get 100% reliability. As we have brought the heat to the surface on the back of the camera, keeping this area cool should have a knock-on effect on the camera's internal temperature, which leaves us with plenty of cooling possibilities here. Having a look on eBay, there are all sorts of old computer and laptop heatsinks and fans available for pretty cheap, so getting a set like this and modding it onto a bottom plate to hold it against the back of the camera is all that it takes to now allow for truly unlimited record times, even in much warmer environments. This really does catapult the camera into being a super reliable tool, and although the heatsink makes it big and bulky, it can be removed, which leaves the camera in a seemingly unmodified state for when it's not doing heavy video work. For a bit more elegance though, I designed a custom plate for the bottom of the camera that can be 3D printed, with the goal here being to strike a balance between practicality and video capabilities. It's designed in separate parts, which allows for an internal tripod screw so that it can attach to the underside of the camera, and this space here is for a battery holder and switch. The fan type this is made for is called a centrifugal fan, and I'm salvaging mine from an old laptop. Once glued in place, the top piece can be added, which has some ducts to direct the air. Once fitted onto the bottom of the camera with the tripod screw, these ducts blast the air up against the back of the camera, which cools it down significantly without obstructing the screen when it's closed. Despite its unobtrusiveness, it works in tandem with the internal copper heat plate we added to allow for unlimited record times in normal ambient room temperatures. It can't keep up with the heat-sinked version in hotter environments, but it does strike a nice balance between usability and cooling performance. So, after being on a journey which began with disassembling the camera and then experimenting with water cooling, finally building an internal copper heatsink, we're left with a camera that not only has much improved 8K video record times, but one that can be paired with some simple homemade attachments that allows it to reliably record in this mode for an unlimited length of time, making it a truly unique video creation tool. Mission accomplished.
So the last question is, why on earth did Canon release this camera with such a poor thermal design? Well, I think it actually comes down to priorities, and primarily this is a stills camera, and knowing that they couldn't get rid of enough heat from the processor without including some sort of fan or having particularly hot areas on the outer body, they just decided to rely on timers and overheating preventions rather than just properly dealing with the issue. And I think they missed a trick here. You see, while photographers would appreciate a small and light camera, videographers don't care as much, and they would not have minded having to add an extra additional unit to this to keep it cool. So what they could have done is used internal heat pipes to dump the heat into the tripod plate or into an area around it, and then made an additional module that could be purchased separately, so marketing there, and then that heat could be pulled out of the camera and gotten rid of through a heatsink. And honestly, I think that that would have been a great thing to do, because they could have sold those probably for like $300 or $400, making even more money on the camera, and then videographers would have been happy as well, because honestly, what other camera can you get that has in-body stabilization, full frame 8K video, and amazing autofocus with great colors to boot? Not many.
So I hope you've enjoyed this video, and if you want to see another one of my projects, particularly if you're into either making videos or photography, you might be interested in my previous project where we literally build a fake sunlight, which is a light source that appears to be at infinity and also a system to mimic blue sky scattering, and it's really interesting, so definitely worth a watch. And you can find a link to it down in the description below. And also, don't forget to check out this video's sponsor, SimpliSafe, as they are really easy to put up. I've got them protecting the studio right now, and it does provide peace of mind. But other than that, I'm Matt, you've been watching DIY Perks, and I hope I see you next time. Goodbye for now.